Hello, this is Corey from the BachScholar YouTube channel and the well-roundedpianist.com. Thank you for joining me today. This is a rather lengthy video. In fact, I don't even know how long it will be because I'm just sort of improvising as I go along. But this is a video on a very important topic for pianists. And I think I've addressed this a little bit on my well-rounded pianist subscription site, but I don't think I've really addressed it fully on YouTube yet. It has to do with editions, with sheet music and with editions, which editions are good, which editions are not so good, and so forth. This is a totally improvised video. I haven't planned it. All I've done is just lined up a whole bunch of music here that I thought I'd talk about. A bunch of books and different editions I'd like to talk about here. And I hope that it brings you enlightenment in terms of knowing more about sheet music and where to get sheet music and what it's all about. The reason I'm doing this video is I had some in-depth discussions with actually more than one student this week that I was teaching on Skype. You know, I teach full-time piano on Skype, and it led me to do this video because it's a very important topic that a lot of pianists just don't know about. I want to bring some enlightenment to you. Before we get going, make sure you pick up a copy of my Sight Reading in Harmony here, the complete edition. This is the best-selling and most highly rated sight reading system in the world right now. I have links below this video where you can get that. Now, let's get down to business. I was teaching invention number 8 to actually 2 students this week. One student, and I had actually 2 separate students, not related at all in any way, come to me with invention number 8 that they're working on. And they both had printed out and purchased and printed out a copy from musicnotes.com. We all know musicnotes.com is probably the largest sheet music company in the world. That has to do with, I mean, with digital sheet music. They don't sell books, as far as I know, but they sell sheet music that you can download here. I actually paid money for this video to download Maple Leaf Rag and to download Invention Number 8 because I wanted to talk a little about these. So as I was teaching this to one of my students, actually it was a couple weeks ago to one student, he played it through and he hit a couple wrong notes, actually more than one wrong note. And I said, I corrected them on his notes. And I have one circled here, one circled here. There's like 3 wrong notes in this that you pay for. I can understand free sheet music having mistakes, even like note mistakes like this, but if you're paying for something, you know, I paid $5 for this, $5 for 2 pages, and there's mistakes, like 3 note mistakes in it, that's really inexcusable. There's really no reason for that at all, especially with a large reputable company like musicnotes.com. So I don't mean to, you know, harp on musicnotes.com, but as I was listening to my student play this with the mistakes, I said, wait, that's a wrong note. You're playing a wrong note here. You're playing a wrong note there. We went back and he said, well, I'm playing the right notes. I'm playing what they say on the sheet music. And I said, well, can I see the sheet music? So he held up his copy like this so I could see it in my camera. This was a Skype lesson. And, you know, I know this piece backwards and forwards, inside and out. So I looked at it and I just looked at it for about a minute or so and found there's a mistake. There's a note mistake here in measure 10. There's 2 note mistakes in measure 16. So my student was actually playing it correctly. He was playing all the correct notes according to the sheet music. But in this case, the sheet music was wrong. Usually it's the other way around. Usually, in most cases, the sheet music is correct, and then the student happens to learn wrong notes. Well, in this case, the fault wasn't the students. The fault was the sheet music. The fault was musicnotes.com. So the moral of the story is you need to be careful on what you purchase. You know, you're not going to know if there's mistakes in something you purchase. But if you purchase something, beware. Beware of mistakes, because they're all over the place, especially on a lot of free music on the internet. Much free music on the internet there's a reason why it's free, because it's not high quality, it's cheap, it's been not adequately prepared, and tends to be mistakes all over the place. But then also in something you pay for, like from musicnotes.com, that's really inexcusable. Then there's Maple Leaf Rag. Okay, there's a couple mistakes here also. They're not as noticeable. They're not as noticeable here, but if you compare this with the original Maple Leaf Rag, which I have here in my book here, that's the book with the maple leaf on it, that they reproduced the original editions. Maple Leaf Rag, okay. Now, if you take, okay, let's look at the beginning here. Okay, I'm gonna go to I'm gonna go to this part here. Okay, now look at it carefully. And this is interesting, because I even think that I have reason to believe that even on the original edition, there's a mistake. And I actually corrected that mistake in my new edition of Scott Joplin Ragtime, 8 Ragtime Classics here, which will be released very shortly. Also, by the way, I have a Joseph F. Lamb Ragtime book and a Zez Confy book. They are going to be released very soon, probably within the next week or so, or a week or two. Anyway, back to the Maple Leaf Rag. Okay, we have, okay, look carefully at the original. If you see the original edition here, published by John Stark and Son in 1899. Okay, there's only one note. But then the second time it happens, when it does it an octave lower, there's two notes. There's not just an F, but there's an A flat. Now, you might think, well, maybe Joplin wanted that. Well, maybe, but let's see what happens the second time. So when the A section comes back, you have the high one up here. You have two notes there, not one. So it's different than the first time. And then when it's an octave lower, you also have the two notes. You have the A flat and the F. So this leads me to believe that I'm absolutely certain, or 99% certain, that whoever printed this Maple Leaf Rag in the office or workshop of John Stark made a mistake. They forgot to include that one note here accompanying that F, the A flat. Now, it's not a big deal. It's just one little note they forgot. So I've corrected that in my Joplin edition. You have to look at things with magnifying glass to make sure everything is correct. I've also found just minor mistakes in the original editions of Joplin's works, since I know them so well, inside and out, backwards and forwards. Anyway, back to the music notes here. Okay, you have, what they do here is they have one note. They do it correctly, they reproduce it correctly there as it is in the original, but then the second time, they don't have the two notes, they have the one note. So they're actually incorrect in their reproduction of the original. So those are the main mistakes here. Also, the manuscript is very small, it's kind of hard to read. So if you get a reputable book, it's probably better than this. So anyway, I wanted to point those out. So you need to be very careful on what, you know, anytime you get something, sheet music, anywhere from the internet, whether you pay for it or not, be very careful. There can be mistakes. There can be mistakes. Usually books tend to be pretty reliable. You know, reliable books like Shermer editions are very reliable editions. Dover editions are very reliable editions. Henley editions, very reliable. They're probably the highest rated of all editions here. Peters editions, this is a Peters edition here of the Bach Conventions. Excellent edition here, I've had forever since I've been a kid. So there are basically two types of editions in books, There are Urtext editions. Urtext comes from the German word, which means original text. And Urtext means literally that they don't change things. They don't change things around, or they don't add things. So I have the Goldberg variations here published by Henley, the Henley edition here. It's all just nothing added, no phrase marks, no staccatos, no dynamics, nothing added by editors. In fact, this is even one with no fingerings, which I prefer, actually. If you can get editions with no fingerings, those, in my opinion, are the best, because that allows you to do whatever you want with your own fingering. So this is a great, reputable edition, and my own edition of the Goldberg Variations here, which is very legible. In fact, I think it's even more legible than the Henley edition. There are many variations here that I stretch out over two pages when Henley only does it like in a page and a half. They sort of cram things more together. So this is an Urtext edition of my own from BachScholar Publishing. And you have this Debussy edition here from Shermer. This is an Urtext, even though Shermer very often is not Urtexts, and they don't say Urtext on here. It really is, because they're not adding things by editors. They just sort of print exactly what was in the original editions. So this is an excellent edition here. And what I'd like to talk about now is which editions are good for which music. Which editions are good for which music? Now, not all composers are good for certain editions. Not all editions represent the time periods in the composers in an equal fashion. Okay, now, for example, I have this Bach book. It's this Bach. I've had this forever, since I was a little kid. I've had this since I was like 8 years old or something. I chose this because I don't have that First Lessons in Bach book. I don't know what happened to it. I lost it. So if you have First Lessons in Bach, the Shermer edition, the yellow edition, look at it. Look at it very carefully. See everything they add. The editors add staccatos. They do this in this Bach book too. They add staccatos, phrase marks, dynamics, all this stuff here, which, you know, it might be good things. I mean, they're okay. I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but you have to be aware that if teachers are teaching this to students who are playing exactly what they see in the music, and it's not necessarily idiomatic for that time period, you have to understand that, you know, this is just edited. A lot of students, piano students, don't know that. They actually think that Bach wrote the dynamics in here and he wrote the staccatos and everything. Those came later. So when Bach wrote his music, he didn't write staccatos, legatos, dynamics, phrase marks. You know, occasionally he would write slurs and things like that, but his scores were pretty sparse in terms of the notational intricacies in it. So this is definitely not an Urtext. generally speaking, Schirmer editions, okay, like the yellow editions here, Schirmer editions, whenever whenever you're buying Bach, Mozart, Schubert, Beethoven, anything from about 1800 or before, generally I would not recommend that. The Mozart, Schirmer Mozart editions, in my opinion, are awful. They're terrible. Because the editors were editing Mozart's music as seen through the lens of someone living in 1860 or something. There was a totally different musical aesthetic then. So if you want to play, you know, a clean and pure Mozart, and if you're a piano teacher and you want to teach it to students in a pure fashion, you need to get an Urtext, like from Henley or Peters or an edition like that that doesn't add anything from editors. So generally speaking, my general rule is I love Schirmer editions. Actually, I do. I love Schirmer editions, but only for music like after Beethoven. Schirmer edition is excellent for Chopin, in my opinion, because two of the main editors for Schirmer were one of them, Mikuli, was a student of Chopin, and the other, Josephi, was in that circle. I'm not sure whether he was a student of Chopin or not, but their markings are very authentic and within the time period and within that idiom. So Schirmer Chopin is great, in my opinion, excellent. Although the manuscripts are kind of hard to read. They could be a little better. The manuscript quality in Schirmer is definitely not as good as Henley, but they're cheap and they are reliable. So I would say for anything after Beethoven, Chopin, Debussy, even some Liszt maybe, although I'm not familiar with Liszt Schirmer, those are really good editions. Anything before 1800, Bach, Mozart, Haydn, Beethoven, Schubert, I would stay away from Schirmer. Okay, so Schirmer is great for some music, not so great for other types of music. On the other hand, I find Henley, as good as they are, I don't know. I'm not crazy about Henley Chopin. I'm not crazy about a lot of later Henley. I think Henley is best on music, the opposite of Schirmer. It's best for music written before 1800. So anything Baroque or classical, Bach, Mozart, Haydn, Schubert, Beethoven, that kind of thing. Excellent with Henley edition, and also excellent with Peters editions, which is another great Urtext. So you're almost guaranteed to get a high quality manuscript for that repertoire of music. So Schirmer for some composers and some styles, and Henley for other composers and other styles. Where Schirmer is lacking, Henley makes up, and where Henley is lacking, Schirmer makes up. So not all editions are created equal. You have to understand that. And not all sheet music you get anywhere on the internet or in books is 100% reliable. There's always bound to be mistakes somewhere. For example, case in point, piano classics here, published by AMSCO Publications, the Library of Piano Classics, very popular book. It has tons of pieces in here. You know, you might think, oh, you know, I get tons of pieces for really cheap. Well, you get what you pay for, because this book is absolutely loaded with mistakes all over the place. I mean, they even get Beethoven's birth and death dates wrong in here. Like, according to them, Beethoven died 10 years before he really did. And I've worked out of this book with some students, and it seems like I find mistakes right and left in here. So, and it's not the greatest I don't know, it's not the greatest manuscript quality either. So you kind of get what you pay for. You know, you get these big, huge bargain books like this, you're bound to run into mistakes. You're bound to run into problems. So be careful on what you get. IMSLP, okay, IMSLP is another topic I want to cover here. IMSLP is great. Actually, everything is for free. It's mostly music in the public domain. You can find just tons of things there. Millions of things are on there now. And I highly recommend IMSLP, actually, for things that you can't immediately find in books. I would recommend, first and foremost, if you can get it in a book, get it in a book. But if you can't get it in a book, or if your funds are limited and you want to save some money, then go to IMSLP. They have great editions. IMSLP is mostly older editions, like from the 1800s and maybe earlier 1900s. They're excellent editions. Actually, most editions from the 1800s are excellent. Actually, they're usually better than most editions today. So I would highly recommend IMSLP. It's free, yes, but it's not free in the sense of cheap and that there's lots of mistakes in the music. The older editions from the 1800s, early 1900s, tended to make fewer mistakes than they do nowadays, and many, many fewer mistakes than somewhere like musicnotes.com, where I think they just hire cheap labor to write their sheet music out for them. Next, after IMSLP, I want to talk about Dover editions. Many of you are familiar with the Dover editions here. This says the Paderewski edition of Chopin, which is the Polish edition. But don't let that fool you. It's actually Dover. It's published by Dover. Dover is a company that specializes in reproducing older editions. So Dover, what they do and what they built their reputation on was they took music. Most of this you can find in IMSLP. And it's not from Dover. It's actually just where Dover got it themselves. They mostly rely on older editions that are in the public domain or were in the public domain when they made these books. And then they reproduce the facsimiles in here exactly as they were. So Dover doesn't actually, as far as I know, maybe they have newer editions where I'm wrong, but as far as I know, Dover doesn't have people in a workshop, you know, transcribing and writing out music like Henley does. See, this is Henley's own manuscript. So they have their own employees writing this out. Whereas Dover editions, which are very cheap but actually reliable, they're pretty good editions. Dover editions they didn't write this out. People in the Dover company didn't write this out. They just photocopied the previously existing editions and put their name on it and their covers and then sold it. That's why they can sell it for so cheap. And that's why Henley is about twice the price of Dover, because Henley is like custom made. They do it themselves, put a lot of care into it. Dover mostly reproduces older editions, which is good. But, you know, it's cheap, but it's good. And then there's also cheap and not so good, like this. Lots of mistakes in here. Probably no mistakes at all in here because it's from older editions in which they took time and care into what they were doing. Then you have also original editions. Original editions are editions like the Scott Joplin Collected Piano Works. This is the one with the maple leaf on it. What they did here, this is from like the 1970s. I don't have the newer edition, but this is kind of ragged. I've had it since I was like 12 or so. These are actual reproductions of the original editions, just like Dover. So they didn't the company that published this book of Joplin's collected piano works, they didn't write this all out. They just reproduced the original cover pages and the original text. And like I said, I found a couple minor errors in here, I think, but they tend to be few and far between. And I have an original edition of Contentment Rag by Joseph Lamb. This is the original edition I got off IMSLP. And I have my book here of Joseph Lamb, 12 Classic Rags, which is an Urtext. I have a whole list of all the mistakes that they made. There are a lot. there actually are a lot of mistakes in here. For example, Contentment Rag, that should be an F, but they wrote a G. So it sounds like, if you play what they have, you get that. It should be, an F at the end, not a G. So that was a mistake of the copyist or whoever made this music. There are other mistakes as well in all of the 12 rags of Joseph Lamb, which I've corrected, and I've listed all those corrections in here. So this is 12 Classic Rags for Piano, New Authoritative Edition with corrections. This is an Urtext. This is my newest edition, which will be out very shortly. Very beautiful edition here of an Urtext. So this is somewhat of a critical edition, a little bit of a critical edition, because I actually have a list and of the errors that were in the original editions here. So I've taken great care and a lot of time to put into that to list and to fix the errors in those 12 rags from the original editions. So, wow, that's a lot. That's a lot right there. So the takeaways from this video and the things that you should immediately take note of are that there are mistakes everywhere in sheet music. On the internet, there's bound to be mistakes in free sheet music. That is music other than IMSLP that are reputable older editions. There are mistakes in music you pay for, such as from musicnotes.com, who apparently hires cheap labor to write out their a lot of their sheet music, which is very low quality. There are almost never mistakes in like Henley editions, although I think I found a couple in a couple editions, but it's not a big deal. These are highly reputable. Very reputable are the Schirmer's editions here, which, like I said, are best for later music, not for Baroque and classical music. I try to the best of my abilities to make BachScholar published or BachScholar editions the best I can possibly make it. I try to the best of my abilities to eliminate mistakes and to do the best I can to not have mistakes. You know, they're always bound to creep in somewhere, but I try very hard to eliminate that because it's, you know, you don't want to run into wrong notes and wrong things when you're learning music from either sheet music, individual sheets like this, or from books. So let me see, that was about all I wanted to say that I can think of about editions. So the takeaways are there can be mistakes everywhere. Not all editions are good for all composers or all styles. You need to be very educated with which editions you pick for which composers or which styles. And beware of mistakes because they can creep up anywhere. You know, I think a lot of piano students for some reason believe anything on a sheet of paper that you get is correct. But you have to understand that people make these. they're not just automated, they're not just made robotically or something, but this maple leaf rag from musicnotes.com, that was made by a person or people who have to actually put in the notes, and then they send it to Music Notes, and then they get paid for it, whatever. And so people do this, and like everything, people are prone to errors. So as a music editor myself, I try very hard. I try my best at trying to eliminate errors and trying to make the music as close as I can to the way that the composer intended in terms of the notes and rhythms, the dynamics, and the expression. So that's about all. I hope you learned something from my little talk about editions, and until we meet again.